Sorry about that. Let's do it. Creepy ghost hunting story.
This happened about 5 years ago when I was 21. Me and my friend Seth got into this app, which showed you ghosts.
I don't know if I've seen this one before.
We go out ghost hunting, but nothing
ghost hunting.
Sometimes a dot would appear.
Pokemon Go, but ghost hunting? That's a thing, though, right?
Ask, how did you die? Stuff
like ghost hunting, ghost hunting app, but it's just like Pokemon Go.
But it was mostly random. One night,
actually kind of cool,
2 a.m.
Is that the real moon? Wait, hold on.
Picked anything up.
Is that drawn or is that the real moon?
But it was mostly
so everything's drawn.
One night, around,
and the moon is real? Am I going crazy? This is not art. This is a real picture of the moon, right? Right? Am I fucking insane? Or did someone draw that? Which one?
Around 2 a.m., Seth suggested going to the cemetery to see if the app picked anything up.
Yeah, it did look a little. I don't know, dude.
I nervously agreed. We started.
It looked like it was like a Photoshop cutout.
Cemetery.
Hold on a second.
Nervously agreed. Around 2 a.m., lined up, but it was mostly random. One night, around.
Like someone took the moon into Photoshop and like keyed out what was around it? And then put the moon in there? It might.
At 2 a.m., Seth suggested going to the cemetery to see if the app picked anything up. I was hesitant,
thinking about it.
I nervously agreed. We started making our way through.
Yeah, absolutely. It doesn't even match. There's no way. There's no way that they drew that.
The cemetery. It was weird as the streets are normally lined.
That's a real moon!
Cars, but they were empty on this night. We walked
That's
down the
no
middle
moon.
Of the road with the app running, but it wasn't picking anything up. We finally made it to the cemetery,
ghost
which
radar.
Was a small, family-owned one where they only buried their own. Seth went up to the gate and started shouting, hoping to get a response on the app, but nothing happened.
Yeah, it's that kind
I was
of
standing
brand.
In the road, feeling unsettled, when Seth starts yelling,
"Is that all you've got?"
I told him to stop disrespecting the dead and we should leave. He tried being funny,
he's
saying,
yelling at the graveyard?
"Oh, I'll make him show up."
What?
And jumped the gate and started stomping.
Is he threatening a ghost?
Screaming.
Show us something.
All of a sudden, our
phone this is
the
first Family Guy episode.
Time. I looked down at my phone, and it was there. We both just stood there, looking at each other, when 10 or so red dots appeared on the radar, and it said it again.
Defense mechanisms activated.
When I looked back up from my phone, Seth was next to me. I said,
"We have got to go."
Wait, he was appeared
as
next to you all of a sudden?
We could hear the street lights turning off one by one from the top of the street, getting closer to us. We took off running as fast as we could. We got about halfway into the neighborhood before running out of breath and having to stop. I felt like I was going to throw up from being scared and winded. Then I heard my phone say something. It was muffled, but I knew what, it said. Being too scared to look at my phone, I looked at Seth, who looked terrified. He nodded at me to get my phone out, so I slowly pulled it out, and it said my name.
Hold on. This looks like Bart Simpson is, like, buried in the soil over here. That's all I can see. Is Bart being buried.
Slowly pulled it out, and it said my name across the top. I turned my phone off.
It fucking looks just like his hair.
This. I'm done.
We made our way back to my
think
house.
Think about it. I think maybe everything here. All right, look at the style of the bush. Does that not look like Marge's hair a little bit? We got Marge's hair. It's the same shape that encompasses Marge's hair. It's like the squiggles like that. We got Bart's hair.
This. I'm done.
Oh, yeah. This is Patty. This is Selma right here. It honestly is. That's the same shape as her hair.
We made our way back to my house and had a cigarette.
The fence is Lisa? Oh my god.
We made our way back to my house and had a cigarette to calm down. We were talking about what just happened, almost not believing it, when I heard my phone again.
He's just smoking now.
This time,
that's just a fucking slowed down
name.
Voice.
We just stood there, frozen, not saying a word, when it went off again and said my brother's name. I took my phone out, turned it on, and deleted the app. I asked Seth to stay the night, but he refused. I can't blame him. When I finally got to sleep that night, I dreamt a muffled voice repeating the word over and over.
Man.
I started to wake up and the words became clearer. My phone was off, with the battery out. But when I turned it over, it was lit up with the app running. It had a red dot about 6 feet from me, still repeating.
Oh my God.
So who was telling the story then?
I woke up the next morning and went to the bathroom. I had a razor-thin cut from my left shoulder to my right hip. I don't know what happened that night.
Marge!
Nothing has happened to me since. Needless to say, I don't mess with that kind of stuff anymore.
I don't mess with that kind of stuff anymore. So what, did he become fucking God of War or what?
I am now.
Doesn't God of War just have like the same scar? Here's one of his more recent ones, Plum Arts. The Horn-Headed Man.
Moonlight peered through my window as I jolted awake.
What kind of fucking haircut is that?
My clamorous breaths disturbed the silence.
His hair just like stops at his ears. It turns into like his head. Is that usually how that works?
...of my dark room. I had just come out of a frightful dream that had me thinking it was all too real. With sweat on my brow, I sat up and grabbed my water from the nightstand and took a sip from the now warmed glass. My hands shook as I recounted my
nightmare. It's not even a fade though, just like, it's the opposite of a fade.
In my dream, I was walking through my neighborhood, the street lights flickering as I made my way down the uninhabited sidewalk.
There's no transition, it's just like...
just a walk through the midnight hours.
Starts and ends.
A block down.
Is this just gonna be the smiley face man story?
Walking slowly towards me. His steps seemed mismatched and labored. He passed a few houses looking straight ahead, neither looking left nor right.
Alright, if you see somebody
fixed on the sidewalk.
If you see somebody wearing a fucking skull.
As I was getting closer to my home, I could
walking
see
down the street, maybe you should get the fuck out of there.
I quickly rushed to my front door and hurried inside. Through my window,
actual capper demon
past my property. I was thinking to myself, oh God, please have him keep going, please. He was just about to walk all the way past my front yard.
You know what I forgot?
His body almost shifted abnormally as he turned to face my home. He just stood there, looking, not moving, just standing there. The man bore the horned head of a skeletal goat. His body was pale and looked fragile, and his fingers were thin and bony. I thought to myself,
you really
what does he
that?
Want? Slowly, he started lifting a quivering arm and pointed right at me. I started to backpedal into the darkness of my house, when all of a sudden he let out an inhuman screech. That's when I woke up. Too frightened to go back to bed, I turned on the television.
I have a lot of
saw
questions.
The local news for early risers was on. My stomach dropped.
It says
my
moth.
Body suddenly turned cold as I listened to the current news
Why?
Report. The news anchor on the television said, "Breaking news: a woman who lived on Columbia."
She's like very pale.
Avenue has been murdered. Local officials say that they received an anonymous phone call from the victim's home. We arrived at the house.
It's just the color of my monitor. It like makes everything
we
look lighter. Almost like she just like
looked
not right
next
for some
to
reason.
The sheriff held
and
up
I looked
the
over
card.
In OBS and she looked
on
fine.
The back of it, I could see the image of the horn-headed man. The officer started to read. One down. Slowly I go. He then lifted his head back up. His blood started trickling from his eyes and mouth.
What?
I sat there shaking, and I couldn't breathe.
What is this story?
Columbia's just 3 blocks away from me. I jumped out of my bed and ran to my window. Something within me made me want to look outside. That's when I saw him. He just stood there, looking, not moving.
I don't get it.
Just looking. The horn-headed man. His body pale and fragile.
Look at his mouth. It's actually the Wu-Tang Clan symbol. You see it? It's literally the Wu-Tang Clan. That's all it is.
And his fingers thin and bony.
I didn't like that one, really. I like their older stuff. That's a good one. Going to the snow.
My name is Ethan, and I'm a photographer. I took a trip last year with my wife to the Colorado Mountains for an art project. My wife is also an avid skier, so she talked me into adding skiing into the trip. We had the option to book a room at a ski resort or rent out a private log cabin. The second one seemed more romantic, so I picked that one. Plus, it didn't hurt that it was cheaper. The cabin was nothing luxurious or anything. It was a single floor, 4-room little thing.
I think that's a two-person bedroom, cabin
a
from
small
the
living room, a kitchen, and a bathroom.
Pretty sure.
It may have been small, but the actual idea of being secluded in a warm log cabin during a blizzard was amazing. However, the storm was interfering with the cable signal, so we didn't have much to do this one particular evening. It was just starting to get dark out at this point, but there was still a decent amount of light outside, so I thought it would be perfect for getting a few shots and videos in the blizzard for backgrounds and wallpapers. I told my wife I'd be back within 10 minutes and slipped on my boots and coat.
My wife is an avid creepypasta fan.
The moment I stepped
so
outside
I
and shut the door, I noticed footsteps
Best
leading up to the
ever.
Door in the snow that had blown under the wooden awning. I could see the prints doubled as whoever left them there turned and went the opposite direction. I was freaked the fuck out.
I like the way
but
the
I wasn't
snow
about
looks.
To go inside and scare my wife. I decided to give in to my curiosity and followed the prints to the right side of the cabin. Right away, I noticed that they led to the bedroom window. My heart froze in fear when I saw this. I could see my wife sitting
my
on the bed using her
became
iPad.
Incredibly huge when
she
I saw
noticed
this.
Me, and I waved. She laughed. I continued to follow the footprints around the cabin to the other side. They led to the living room window on the other side. Someone was stalking us. But how long ago was the question? I found myself standing there for a good minute asking myself if I should follow the footprints anymore. For whatever reason, I decided I would. They were now leading away from the cabin. I knew I was following the prints to where this person was going, not coming from, simply by the boot marks. I followed the prints away from the opening and into the trees. That was where I saw him. A man wearing a black coat facing a tree, slouched down looking at the ground. He was still as a statue, and I could see the snow piling up on his hood and shoulders.
The Dementor!
I froze in my tracks, trying not to make a sound. I would have thought to ask him if he needed help otherwise, but this guy was just standing there, not
that
doing
looks
anything
like, a fucking
like some
Dark
kind
Souls
of deranged
enemy.
Freak.
Fucking
I
out
started
of there.
To gradually move backwards without even turning around, making sure this man didn't turn around or notice me. When I got out of visual distance, I turned around and stomped through the snow back to the cabin. When I slammed the door shut, my wife came over to see what was wrong. I saw worry in her eyes. I guess she saw the worry in mine. She knew I saw something, and after a few minutes of harassment, I finally told her what I saw.
Of harassment? Did he say?
She immediately started packing her things, telling me we're leaving right away.
You like use
I
any
told
other
her
word.
No, we're not going anywhere. I would not get a refund for leaving early, and I wasn't
I
about to up and leave just because some weird guy was walking around outside. She made a point of locking both locks on the door and making sure all of the windows were sealed shut. For the rest of the night,
you know
we read
you, like,
stuff
turn
on our
too
iPads.
Far to one side, like, quickly,
I reviewed
kinda, like,
the pictures and videos
your, like...
I had taken so far. We turned out the lights earlier. There wasn't much else to do. What if he's still out there? I remember my wife asking me. There's no way he's still out there. I then assured her. Listening to the wind blowing outside, along with the small flakes of snow hitting the windows, was strangely relaxing, and I knew I'd be able to fall asleep quickly.
What the fuck did they go to sleep for?
Except if it wasn't for...
Come on, you knew that was gonna happen.
A knock at the bedroom window.
What the fuck did you think was gonna happen?
We were both still awake, and we both knew it was a knock from a person. I ushered my wife out of bed and out into the living room without turning on any lights. There was nothing to use as a weapon whatsoever. Our only option was to run before something might happen. I told my wife we'd have to forget our luggage and make a dash for the Jeep. We slipped on our boots and coats in the dark in a matter of seconds, and when we heard a knock at the living room window from the opposite side of our car, we took that opportunity to run. I pressed the unlock button, so grateful I chose to have remote locks on my Wrangler, and we hopped in. The car started with ease, and as soon as the headlights flashed on, the man was standing facing the log cabin on our side now. Not a window, just facing the wall of the cabin in the same position I had seen him in earlier, as if he were hiding his face. We drove to the nearby ski resort without much trouble in the Jeep. We stayed there for the night and went back the next day to the log cabin to collect the things we left behind. He wasn't there.
Yeah, I think a lot of people who do like the YouTube reactions on Twitch usually have like kind of overlay. So this is my crappy overlay. Oh, I got hiccups. All right. One more llama. One more llama story. I thought it said carry true. I was like, what the hell? For some reason, the title of the game was, or the video was lowercase. Scary True Pool Horror Stories. From the winter to the water.
It was approaching the end of summer, and my friends and I wanted to do some cool, mischievous things before going back to school. So, we had the genius idea one night to sneak into a nearby community pool. It was actually only a couple blocks away.
Art style,
it's right
always
smack
so
in the
different.
Middle of a residential area.
I guess they're just
so
like
instead
always
of sitting on a main
improving.
Road or something, it actually just sat around a bunch of houses on a quiet
didn't know what
road.
What the fuck we're looking at for a second there?
During a hot day, the little parking lot would be full, and the spot would be bustling. But at 1 a.m, the place was of course dead. There's obviously a big fence surrounding the whole.
I think that's
entrance,
real water,
as well as a cage that gets closed up when the place
that's
closes.
Weird.
So our best way was to get in through the side. We snuck into the backyard of a neighboring house and
helped
the fence
so
over
smug.
To the pool. It was as easy as that.
Except that does not look
the
good.
The four of us took off our shirts and jumped into the pool.
Yeah, that's like
retrospect,
some weird water
wasn't
texture.
Smart, since any of the neighbors could have heard the splashes and just called the police. But we were dumb high schoolers.
Oh, there's Lisa again.
It was very, very dark within that hole enclosing. This pool had no lights, which is why it closed at sunset. James, Courtney, and Alyssa were on the other side of the pool.
I went
as
pool
I was
hopping
kind
one
of
time.
Doing my own thing at first, swimming around
it was not
and getting
a good experience.
My face wet. I saw Alyssa get out of the pool shortly after.
I
and
lost
run away.
My Birkenstocks.
I swam over to see what was going on. She was just going to the water fountain, though.
This was like 20 years ago.
The three
too.
Of us just bopped around in the water for a bit, and eventually we heard Alyssa jump back into the pool from the other side.
But
it
wasn't
too dark
her!
To see much more than her black hair covering her face. But just then, we heard Alyssa playfully call something to us as she was walking back to the pool.
She was a demon all along.
The three of us
along.
In the
no,
pool
no, no,
looked
she's...
at each other. I know they were doing the same thing as me.
Wait, but who's
hands.
That?
There were three of us on this side of the pool, and here came Alyssa walking over to our side. So who was that on the other side? Alyssa got in, but the three of us were distracted, looking at the head bopping around the water across the pool. James said across
pool
the pool,
tentacle monster? I don't think I've
that?
Ever seen that music video.
Not even 2 seconds later, the head went underwater and disappeared from view.
We took this time to whisper to each other, mostly things like, what should we do? What if that's security?
And what if it's security?
Suddenly I felt
Leave
something
her
grab
there.
My leg with
Get out
force
of there.
And tried
she's,
pulling me down into the water.
She's too stupid.
I kicked, splashed, and yelled for help. James came over to pull me out of the pool, while the girls were already
Guys,
running for
Guys, I think
for it,
security
screaming.
For this pool, this random person's pool,
got
in the pool with us.
It wasn't until I got to the stairs
us.
Of the pool that the grip on my leg was released, and I
it's
was
It's security!
Free. We hopped the same fence we climbed over to get in, and ran all the way back to Alyssa's house. I was convinced that whoever that was a security guard. That is, until they literally tried to pull me under the water. We don't know what to think.
What?
There are a few possibilities. Maybe it was just another kid messing with us, maybe it was a security guard who went way too far, or most likely, it was a dangerous person who had ill intent.
Or maybe it didn't happen. I thought that one was going to be cooler. Alright, let's find some more pulp ghosts. All the ghosts. Do a, what's his name? Top five. What do we have here? See, I like ones like this. Like, all right, five disturbing cases of unsolved mass disappearances. Like, it sounds not that great, but. I think it could be interesting, possibly.
The mysterious disappearance of the Anjikuni people.
Oh, wrong one.
During the harsh Canadian winter of 1930, fur trapper Joe LaBelle searched for shelter from falling snow and bitter cold. He was close to Lake Anjikuni in the northwestern territory and knew there was an Inuit settlement in the area. As he stumbled into the village, he noticed how eerily silent it was. On previous visits, Joe had been greeted by a warm and bustling community. He carried on, hoping to find lodging, but soon realized the place was completely deserted.
I mean, is that really that bizarre, though?
Joe found abandoned huts, smoldering fires,
aren't Inuit
meals left out uneaten,
sometimes nomadic
and
too,
possessions and weapons left intact. As he continued to search,
they usually like move around the tundra.
That the people of Lake Anjikuni had vanished. Something had happened that forced the entire
community to abandon
their homes. I
guess if it was an established community, wouldn't have moved around.
Just as disturbing was that every single dog in the village appeared to have starved to death. Suspecting something terrible had happened, and knowing the Inuit community would never leave behind valuable commodities for no reason,
the dogs all
Joe
starved
hiked
to death?
A few miles to the nearest telegraph station to alert the authorities. Hours later, the Royal Canadian Mounted Police arrived.
They are, I mean, that's what I thought.
As they traveled to the village, they
I
were
guess
joined
they don't
by
have
trapper,
to always
Armand
be, though.
Lund,
it's probably
his two
different.
Sons. Who gave a curious account of what they had seen a few days earlier.
Whatever.
They claimed that they had witnessed an airborne object heading
awesome
in the direction
one.
Of Lake
Anjikuni
that appeared to change shape as it moved. If that wasn't strange enough, when the Mounties searched the village
the
and saw for themselves what Joe had described,
so in
they
Canada,
made another extraordinary discovery.
The Mounties are not just the cops, right? Like,
had been opened and
if you go out and you get pulled over, you don't get pulled over by the Mounties, right? That's something completely different.
How
they're
could
like,
a community of around 30
the fuck
men,
are the Mounties?
Women and children disappear without a trace, taking their dead with them? The Mounties immediately ordered a search party
just,
for
like,
the missing
do
villages,
things in the woods.
But failed to find the village
oh, shit.
That had died of starvation, taking their dead with them.
Hit a button by accident.
The Mounties immediately ordered a search party for the missing villages.
They're like forest rangers. They're like a national
they did,
forest.
However,
okay.
Discover a tied-up pack of dogs.
They're
fed.
They're like our FBI. Okay. So
they're
like special forces. More.
Before being covered by snow.
Like elite.
They also stated they witnessed strange pulsing lights in the sky above Lake Anjikuni.
Law enforcement.
Although it's worth pointing out, these could have been the Northern Lights.
Army.
Although the officers claimed they were not like the natural phenomena that they were used to seeing.
I really,
After
honestly,
a long
my
and
only
arduous investigation. The RCMP officers used berries found nearby to determine that
is
the village
Dudley Do-Right is the only Mountie I
months.
Think I've ever really like seen before.
However, it was apparent from the smoldering fires and prepared food that someone else had been using the village after they fled. The RCMP eventually concluded
Dudley Do-Right kind of gives them a bad name.
Permanent abandonment, given the nomadic nature of the Inuit
that
people.
Dog is pissed.
However, they did note
who turned into a fucking vampire.
Their weapons and provisions. As for the lights and craft witnessed,
God.
They were never explained. For many, this left a lot of unanswered questions, and several did not believe this explanation, which has left the case wide open to speculation. The most popular theory is that the Inuit were the victims of a mass alien abduction, and the strange aircraft and lights back this up. Others believe some malevolent spirit was responsible, possibly a Wendigo. The evil spirit, said to inhabit the forests and Great Lake regions of Canada and America.
What's happening in this video right now? Is this guy like trying to block out the aliens?
And the desire to cannibalize other humans in those that fall under
its influence. Or is he just like tripping out?
Others believe the Inuit sky god, Tonga Rasuk.
Kind of looks like he's on shrooms and he's looking at his hand.
Another popular theory is that the members of the village were somehow pulled into another dimension. However, like
that,
many
that little kid knows
the truth
something
about what really happened at Lake Anjikuni.
The way they're looking at the camera
has become distorted with the passage of time.
They know.
And fact has given way to
they
fiction.
They know where they are.
Yet we think you'll agree, the story remains an odd one with no real conclusion, either rational or supernatural.
Yeah, the terror.
Whatever the truth, the mysterious
the Inuit woman in the terror
of the Anjikuni
was pretty
people
cool.
remains one of Canada's most enduring mysteries. One that continues to trouble the vast northern wilderness to this day.
Maybe it was the terror. It came and killed them because they ate maybe some of their own.
The Gill family disappearance. When an entire family of six disappears, you would think that the whole world would
maybe
know
they grew
about
gills
it.
And went into the ocean.
However, in the case of the
and
Gill
that's
family,
why that's the name.
There appears to be little information outside of Argentina, the place where it happened. The Gill family lived on the La Candelaria Estancia, where Menko Gill worked as a ranch hand, and his wife Margarita worked at the local school.
That kid would be scared.
The Estancia, or ranch, was around 500 hectares, and was located in a town close to the city of Parana.
Yeah, look at this statue, it's just a deer getting attacked by like a dog. It's just like, stop, please.
The land belonging to Alfonso Goyetti, who was also Menko's boss. On January 13th, 2002, the family traveled the 30 kilometers to Valier to attend the wake of their friend, Maximo Vega. This was the last time anyone saw the family. 56-year-old Menko, his 26-year-old wife,
that's a great picture.
Margarita, and their collective children, Maria, 12, Osvaldo 9, Sophia 6, and Carlos 2 disappeared off the face of the earth.
You can tell where her eyeballs are.
In mid-March of that year, Mencho's brother Otto tried to contact the family, but got no response. Then his sister Luisa traveled to her brother's home, but again got no response. Then in June, Alfonso Goyetti showed up at Luisa's house asking where the family were, saying he was concerned they had not returned from a three-month vacation.
Like a weird filter
he even suggested that they could be staying in relatives in Santa Fe, or that perhaps they had traveled to look for another job in the north.
This static footage is great too.
Luisa was suspicious
man
of this
discouraged while knocking on door.
Previously, Goyetti had only ever given them a maximum of 10 days leave, and after checking with friends and neighbors, none of them were aware they had planned a trip, and it seemed unlikely as neither of them had a car.
Sounds like they got
it
murdered.
Was also revealed that Margarita had not picked up her latest salary. Luisa reported the disappearance to the police. However, initially they leaned towards the hypothesis that the family had indeed gone on vacation and perhaps found another
family
job
holding
and not returned.
Hands, B&B.
Another relevant fact is that the family cell phone of the telephone company CTI continued to be active until April 2003.
I think it might be this guy creeping up behind them.
It took until July 2003. 18 months after their disappearance, for police to investigate and search the area, but they found nothing. In the years that followed, investigators interviewed several people, searched various areas, and handed out missing person flyers, but nothing was found. In 2008, the fields in the area were excavated, wells were dug out, and in the family home the floor was raised. Traces of blood were found using luminol. However, the samples did not show the Gill's genetic pattern, although experts made it clear that over time the samples had been contaminated.
Interesting.
Nothing much happened for the next 8 years, until on June 16, 2016, Alfonso died in a traffic accident. Alfonso's death produced an unexpected twist in the case. Armando Nani, a rural contractor who carried out planting work in the Goethe field and who knew Menko Gil, came forward. Nani hadn't wanted to speak before, out of fear of Goethe. But with Goethe dead, he made an extraordinary claim. He said that the Gills did not go on a trip to find work elsewhere. They were in fact buried in the area. He claimed that 20 days before the family disappeared, Menko Gil dug two wells, one in the bed of a stream that at the time was dry. Armed with this new information, on October 2017, investigators began excavating the two wells. However, just 2 weeks later, they had abandoned the dig. The first well did contain bones, but they belonged to animal remains. The second well, that was now filled with water, posed a significant and costly problem. And the additional
funding needed to be approved by the judicial branch. What if they all fell into the well at the same time?
Subsequently, the excavation stopped, and the field was planted with soy and returned to its normal purpose. The last thing that was known is a report produced by
firefighters. This one's kind of lame. They just keep showing the same three pictures over and over again.
And provided a fact. The land had been removed previously, which would indicate previous disturbances or digging. And that is where the investigation is today. Nearly 20 years after an entire family disappeared, their fate still remains unknown, and the mystery rolls on.
The mystery.
For the family, this must be agonizing, knowing that in all likelihood, their loved ones are buried in the field in which they worked and lived. Will the mystery ever be solved? Will they ever get justice and a decent burial? Or will money, or lack of it, prevent all of that? What's your thoughts and theories on this one?
Now, let's do another one. Let's do something different. I was just thinking of something else before. Now I can't even. All right. Let's do. Haunted places.
Asia is the largest and most populous continent on the planet. And with such a rich and diverse history, it's home to thousands of myths, legends, and horror stories.
Who is that?
So as you can imagine, haunted locations are abundant. They range from ghost stories surrounding the Great Wall of China to Singapore's most haunted beach that was the scene of horrific war crimes. Here are five of some of the most haunted and terrifying locations in all of Asia.
It's Tommy.
Bam. Hit the lights, sit back, and enjoy.
Milting Tommy.
Bangor Fort. Bangor Fort was built in the Rajasthan state of India in the 17th century and is located in the now ruinous abandoned city of Bangor, around 300 kilometers from Delhi. It's listed as the most haunted place in India.
I keep thinking of Angkor Wat too.
And is one of Rajasthan's most popular tourist attractions. The main reason for interest is the two enduring mysteries that surround it. And the belief that the fort is teeming with paranormal activity.
Yeah, Bangor City.
In fact, the Archaeological Survey of India has banned tourists from visiting the site from sunset to sunrise.
Is this the haunted
it's
castle?
It's the only legally haunted place recognized by the government of India.
I've heard about this, actually.
It's believed that if a person enters the fort after sunset, they will never come out. According to one of the myths,
a warlock,
the fort
like,
was
curse
cursed
it.
By Guru Balu Nath.
Yeah.
Who initially sanctioned the construction of the city on the condition that his sacred meditating place that was nearby should not be overshadowed by the buildings, and if they did, the city would fall into ruin. Not heeding the warning, the building cast a shadow over his retreat.
Oh no.
And true to his word, he supposedly cursed the city, causing it to fall into ruin.
I think it's a different one I'm thinking
of. It's said Balu's tomb can be found underneath the rubble. Another legend is that of Princess Ratnavati. When Ratnavati turned 18, she was inundated with marriage proposals, one of which was a sorcerer named Singhia Servra.
This is the one I'm
thinking
of. He
soon realized he had no chance of catching the princess's eye, so decided to use black magic to try and entice her. He took his opportunity when he saw one of her maids purchasing perfume from the local market, and placed a black magic spell on the perfume. The princess became aware of what Servra had done and smashed the perfume bottle against a rock that rolled and crushed him.
What?
It's said that before he died, he cursed the entire land. And the following year, a battle ensued and the whole
population of the city,
threw the
perfume on a rock and it crushed him?
Including the princess, were killed. It's said that the spirit of the princess has returned to the fort in several different forms, in an attempt to lift the spell from Bangor. Of course, researchers have dismissed these claims as nothing more than legends, but the locals are convinced the fort is a haven for ghosts, and many say that even though
Bangor like is deserted at fucking night,
strange
shit.
Noises can be heard, including music and dancing coming from the ruins, as well as the sounds of a woman screaming and crying. Along
that with actually looks like, you know what this looks like? Map from Final Fantasy Tactics? Like one of the walled cities? Like, I forget what the fuck it's called. It really looks like one of the areas that you fight in Tactics, though.
From anyone who has visited the fort and whether they experienced anything strange. Mimaland, Malaysia.
Mimaland?
Mimaland is an abandoned theme park in Gombak, Selangor. And was Malaysia's first theme park. It opened in 1971, and one of its most impressive attractions was the prehistoric animal park that contained huge dinosaur models. It also had a giant maze, a water slide, and a fishing lake.
Those pictures are kind of weird.
For many years, it was the go-to attraction for tourists and locals, until in January 1993, a 27-year-old Singaporean lost his life in a freak accident on the water slide.
On the water slide?
The incident resulted in the temporary closure of Mimaland as safety improvements were ordered. Shortly after it reopened in May 1994, a minor landslide caused damage to the walls of the pool and resulted in muddy water leaking in. The area was closed to Mimaland. The public, and after concerns about safety and security, Mimaland was closed.
They've got nothing in Action Park.
Today, the eerie reminders of the once bustling theme park still survive, and it's slowly being taken over by nature. Despite locals being keen for the area to be redeveloped, it's remained untouched and decaying since the day it closed. However, this has not stopped the visitors who now flock to the
site. If you're walking in the woods and you just like saw this, it's like, oh my
god. It's long been thought that Mimaland is a gateway to the paranormal world.
What?
And there have been many spine-chilling tales of hauntings and strange happenings. In fact, the problem of trespassers is so bad that the place has security guards and dogs in place to try and prevent entry to the site. But the vastness and location of the theme park makes it difficult to keep people out, and it's feared that their relentless pursuit of the paranormal is putting them in danger. Many people also believe the land sits on a mythical area inhabited
ghosts.
By Orang Bunyan, a supernatural being
Orang
in Bunyan?
Folklore,
which is a presence that is only visible to those with spiritual sight. If they are sighted, their appearance
actual
is almost
ghosts.
Human-like with elf-like features.
What the fuck?
Although these beings are normally
that doesn't
harmless,
look like anything.
They have supposedly been blamed for the disappearance of children or people getting lost in the forest.
That's funny.
Changi Beach. Changi Beach is found in the eastern region of Singapore, and today it's a tranquil place with stretches of stunning white sand lined with coconut palms and the scene of some of the most extraordinary sunsets in the world. However, this beautiful place hides a dark past and was once a slaughter ground for the Japanese during the Second World War. When they swept in and occupied the British colony of Singapore, they are adamant that the sand is sometimes bloodstained.
Dead peoples.
And it's claimed decapitated heads have been seen bobbing up and down in the sea.
Oh my god.
As well as headless bodies roaming the beach, allegedly unable to travel to the afterlife until they are complete again. Fishermen still get human skulls caught in their nets. And each tide covers and then
their boats are
hundreds of memorials and urns left by mourning families on the sand. Anyone who dares to touch or remove them is said to get cursed. The locals believe that the innocent victims of Japanese war crimes cannot rest at the injustice of their deaths and haunt the beach. Sadly, it seems that they will never find peace, as ironically, the building was taken over by Japanese forces and used as a prison.
Which is like all awful
the inmates
Japanese
were treated harshly,
Imperial
with
Army
many
crimes.
Of them being executed and tortured in the basement.
Lots of ghosts. That's what that one like coal mining island is. It's like completely haunted. And like all these dead slaves and stuff. Alright, I got a good one. Why can I never remember the name of their fucking channel? The fuck is the name of the channel? Okay, there it is. Wait, that's not the name of it. What the fuck?
If the guy?
What do we have here? I'm just trying to find one that's not like completely crazy.
She said she searched her house and didn't find anything.
She searched her house, not us. We'll find something.
Fucking. Something was pulling my hair. These guys. Something was pulling my hair.
Oh my god. We're gonna set up some cameras in your house tonight and try to figure out if there's someone.
Hey guys, before this video starts, please check out our Instagrams. Our usernames are right here. So please follow both of our accounts if you want to support us.
No, I don't think so. Hello, give me more ghosts, man.
Let's try to smash 100,000 likes. Activity in her house at night. She says she's been hearing noises like stomping, pipes bursting, and even laughing.
Yeah, these guys are like moving up. He's got like an Adidas tracksuit on now. Causing these
noises. She sent us this video.
They just get back from like Slovakia? What the hell's going on?
So today we're gonna
the same sound I make when I get scared.
The night and try to find out who or what is causing these problems.
So what's up, Parker?
Does he have a big ass watch? But he always wears the same shirt. I'm starting to notice.
She searched her house and didn't find anything.
She searched her house, not us. We didn't search it. We'll find something.
Well, he wears the fucking sheriff shirt. This is like some cosplay bullshit. Yeah, I'm the sheriff around these parts.
Yo, dude, we're here.
All right, let's see what she has to say.
All right, dude, let's do this.
He says 20 of them. Please, we need 100,000 likes or we won't be able to stop the murderer stalker.
Hi.
Megan.
I was like, wait, what? What do they have to like blur out?
Yeah. If you're ready, do you want to sit down so we can start talking?
Yeah.
Was that like her Instagram?
Okay, all right.
No, it was like her Instagram.
Thank you for letting us sit down with you.
And then they got rid of it.
Can you tell us a little bit about what you've been?
Yeah, it was like her. It was like her name.
Like I said in my email.
Her shirt's fine.
I've been hearing noises at night.
Right.
Okay, so I hear things breaking and I hear things crawling. And the worst part is,
it did make it look like it was her boobs though, but it obviously was not.
So with this laughing, do you think it's coming from inside of your house?
There's something else I didn't tell you. Last night when I was sleeping, something.
Something what?
Something
was pulling my hair.
What?
Okay, so
she looks like she's like just woke up
and
too.
I woke up and my hair was being pulled. Not
her eye was like all
pulled,
weird.
But like pulled hard. Like there was somebody dragging me off the bed.
What do you mean?
And kind of slurring her words too.
I started screaming. Then the pulling stopped. I looked around my room and under my bed and I couldn't see anything. Like, I was alone.
I just can't see any reasonable life.
She's like really not doing well.
So do you think a person could have done that?
I honestly don't know.
Megan, listen, we're going to set up some cameras in your house tonight.
Yeah, they do tend to get possessed.
Okay,
so if you want to show us where we'll be sleeping tonight, and then we'll set up the cameras.
Okay, let me show you to your room.
Okay. Thanks.
Let me show you to your room.
This is the room.
Okay, thanks. Alright,
looks like we're sharing a bed again.
Don't remind me.
Just let me know.
Don't remind me.
Thanks.
How embarrassing.
Bro, do you think she's just imagining this?
Bro, what do you think, bro? Bro,
if
what do you
there
mean?
Was some dude pulling her hair, she would have seen it.
There's always a point in the video when they do this and they're like, bro, what do you think? I don't know, man. What do you think? I don't know. I don't know. Do you want to just go back? I just want to leave. Do you want to leave? I don't know. Let's just go to bed.
Okay,
set up all the
so
giant cameras.
Some cameras now. Pretty
cool. Hey.
Hey.
Hi, Megan.
Yeah.
Hi, I know this is weird, but can we put a camera in your room?
Who?
Yeah, sure, that's fine.
Okay.
Yeah, come on in. Don't mind the mess.
Okay.
There's no carpet.
Okay, so Megan, can you show us what happened when your hair was being pulled?
Yeah, so I was like laying in my bed like this, and something just like kept pulling my hair. And it kept pulling it harder and harder.
Good thing when they got the blur action going.
No, I was all alone.
Okay. Did you check under the bed?
No, I didn't.
Do you mind getting out for a second? Just so we can, like, kind of take a closer look at this?
Yeah.
I'm gonna just, like, feel like have her put pants on for this video. I don't understand.
Yo! Dude, what is that? Is that a hole? Megan, how long has this hole been here?
I don't know, I just noticed it, like, right now.
You just noticed this right now?
Yeah.
You never
No.
Whatever, let's just...
It's like right a fucking now. Giant
let's
hole.
Let's move your bed a little bit over tonight, just so we can keep a camera on this hole. Okay.
Okay.
All right, I think okay. That's it. All right, let's go.
She
all right,
let's go. Sounds like she's on dude, something, kind of. Bro,
I don't know, let's just go to sleep now.
Right. Yeah, she definitely sounds a little drunk or something. Also, that room was nasty. I guess, yeah, it could be English second language. That's a good point. So they make her sleep in the room with a giant hole in the wall? Maybe that's a bad... Like, check what's on the other side of the hole. So stupid. It's the guy from the last video.
Wake up, dude. She's screaming.
I know, I hate when I wake up and there's a hand coming out of the hole next to my head. They grab my hair.
Let's go.
Yo, what's wrong?
What's wrong?
There's something in the wall.
What?
Something grabbed me in the
from
wall.
The hole?
Yeah.
What do you mean?
How did you get in the wall?
There was an arm.
Yeah, let's go. Let's go.
There was an arm.
Come on, let's go. Gotta get out of here.
No. Let's just leave. Come on. Let's go. Let's go. 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 The hell is it?
We gotta go.
Oh my God. That was like the scene from Signs.
Okay.
Yeah, dude, that was the scene from Signs. Oh, well, that's good. We're still trying to figure out how the man got in the walls.
Hey guys, thank you for watching.
I don't know how it happened. Here it is. This is like one of my favorite movie scenes ever. I've been trying to like put this into an edit I've been making. 2-year-old Romero Valadares. This video was taken yesterday after.
Move, children. Vamanos.
Vamanos. I love that part. My son won't stop growing. Yeah, I've seen that one. We'll watch it sometime. What else do we have here? Boom, 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 boom. You know what's a channel I like, actually? I haven't seen this one yet. It's not exactly spooky. It's kind of spooky. It's a murder mystery channel, That Chapter. So he always does... He's pretty proliferous. He makes a lot of videos.
And in this whole video, what we got is here. Let me tell you.
But if you like whodunits, like cold case kind of stuff, this guy is actually really cool. I like him.
In Cottonwood. Cottonwood is in California. You know, the up part near Redding.
Well, what's up, Philip? How you doing? Redding.
You know how you drive up and down? In the shadow of Mount Shasta.
Mount Shasta? I've heard that before. Isn't that like in a song?
Tales of some kind of unsolved mysteries and aliens and that.
Yeah,
kind
it's
of
a good channel. I would recommend subbing to it. They put out a lot of content. It's just like nice to have a new
would very much like this case
one to watch every week, I guess,
mystery.
If you like to sit down
maybe
and watch.
Aliens. Who knows? But anyway, you know, Cottonwood is about as interesting.
I know it's a soda, but isn't it? I feel like I've heard that in a song
but
before.
But thankfully,
though.
You know, that's not the subject of today's video. Mark Duenas is. We are going to tree things.
Like the shores of Mount
video.
Shasta.
2012. Shasta
where,
County.
Where the hell is that from?
And get into it. Or give it a goo. Or whatever.
I think it's there. I wish I had, the patience to get haircuts
in
anymore.
In Cottonwood lived the Duenas family, a family of seven. And on May 4th, 2012, the family attended a high school baseball game where
yeah, I really liked
Duenas,
the
youngest,
production value, kind
of. The baby of the family in his final year of high school was batting away. It was a beautiful, sunny afternoon. These stories always start this way. Casey was the only one still at home as he was finishing up high school. The Duenas family had four other youngins, all lads. You got your Jason, your Jacob,
cut that hair for
your
a long
Tyler,
time.
Your Troy, and your Casey. But they all lived out of town apart from Jason, who lived next door with his own family. And Casey, of course, who still lived at home. But they were a tight-knit family. Like, they were, at that baseball game, parents Mark and Karen, you know, proudly looked on. Mark and Karen had been together since their high school days, since they were both 17. And they were both...
Well, one of them's gonna die.
They were Mormons, married young, and by the time 2012 came along, it would be 33 years. When they were both...
Yeah, you don't want someone to be able to grab your hair.
Their marriage, by all accounts, you know, was still going strong. They would, like, regularly go on dates, that kind of stuff. Karen was a homemaker until the kids
were
old. Oh,
dude, look what it is.
And then she taught at Shasta College, where she was beloved. And she was actually heading
Shasta
to nursing
College.
School herself. Now that the kids were all grown up, she wanted to start her own career. Mark, he was a UPS driver, up at the crack of dawn. So this was like a
what's
lovely
that
day.
Picture of his kid? It's like the whole frame's taken up by some other dude's head.
Karen headed back to their house, while Casey, he followed a little bit later, and then he would head off that evening, that night.
I kind of want to go to a baseball game.
15 showing of the Avengers for, you know, a Friday night flick.
Free Avengers?
He arrived home
in America?
To a darkened house. Lights off, doors to his parents' separate bedrooms were closed. Mark and Karen.
This is that chapter.
Bedrooms. As Mark, he would have to be up early, you know, for his driving job, and he also
free Avengers?
You know, snored, so Karen probably fucked him out. Anyways, Casey.
He's collabed with like
fell asleep.
Brain Bop
I mean,
before and stuff
like
that.
That's what we know of until about then, because after that, it gets a bit iffy. Next thing Casey knew, Mark was bursting in the door, telling him to get the hell up and go next door to Jason's. Jason, you know, the oldest son, he was a volunteer firefighter because something had happened to Karen. This was at 12:56 a.m. on May 5th. And Mark made a 911 call.
Why?
So listen up. The quality of this call, it's not great. I'm not going to subtitle all of it, though, because I want you to listen to it for yourself and maybe decide what he's saying, because it will come up later in the story.
So many of these 911 calls, it always ends up the 911 call is them, like, acting, like, 90% of the time. It's so fucking weird. Because it does sound real sometimes when someone's really frantic and just like, I just killed my wife, but they're like trying to hide it.
911, your emergency.
I got my wife's sick. I'm going everywhere.
You need an ambulance?
I killed my wife.
Hang on, let me get to a medical dispatcher. Hold on, sir.
Is that what he said?
This is
911. What's the address you need an ambulance at?
Yes, I need 20481 Robinson Glen Drive, Cottonwood, California.
Tell me exactly what happened.
I just came in the room. I heard her. And she's got blood everywhere. I don't know. I have no idea.
What happened? Is she awake?
I need somebody here right now.
Like, he doesn't sound that desperate. I don't know.
She's bleeding from?
No, I know. I just blood everywhere.
Okay.
I don't know where it's coming from.
Are you with her now?
Yes. Oh, it's in her chest.
Operation.
Put that on pause.
Oh, it's in her chest.
So Jason, he was awoken, you know, by Casey. Well, Jason was actually already awake.
Yeah, that's a crazy call.
You know, after 911 call and
emergency
services arrived. There was a lot of blood. Karen was pronounced dead at the scene. She had been stabbed to death.
It's in her chest. My wife is bleeding.
Began, you know,
I don't know where from.
Snoop around. Now, footprints were found in the back garden near Karen's window.
Oh, it's in her chest.
Who owned the foot? Karen's bedroom faced the back garden. The screen on the window was broken. It had been cut open. And there were prints which led from her window to the fence, to a gate, and then to a small canal out back.
Yes, I never really thought how easy you could just
that,
like cut through
trail
a
went
fucking
cold. But another neighbor who
mesh
said he saw a
screen.
Car racing
not really
over
a
there
fucking door.
Just around that time. And some other neighbors said they saw, you know, strange folk loitering around the place. Happy having that now. I mean, what more do you need?
Strange folk.
But for all this,
is that a Hobbit reference?
Was missing. The place was.
They wouldn't see. Did anyone get that?
So possibly, you know, a burglary gone wrong. Classic, am I right? You know, somebody tried to break in. They didn't know Karen would be there. They were surprised. And then, knifey to the wifey. You know, it's possible. Technically, anything is possible. But is it probable? After all, the screen was cut, but the shutters were fine, not moved as if someone, you know,
yeah, that's a little suspicious.
Like, snuck in. So
but anyone
even a
could
blind
fix that.
Man could see where this was leading, and it was leading to the only other guy in the house, the guy who conveniently didn't share a bed, with the woman who was murdered in hers, Marky Mark and the Funky Hunch. But what was his story? He said that evening they were watching TV together. Karen went to bed before him. He stayed up a little longer to watch the Giants game before heading off himself. Once again, to their separate bedrooms. He then, quote, heard weird screaming, like a cat. You know, and he started snooping around and he eventually wandered in and found her.
I'm asleep. What? I hear crazy noise.
What?
And you know, you hear a cat sound like, it wasn't cats, it was a weird scream.
Talking or?
No, I just heard.
I heard a weird screaming.
And then what'd you do from there?
I ran. I got up, and because I didn't want those whatever was going on to wake up my wife, because I, you know, I'm sensitive like that. And I went to that door by the kitchen, opened it up, and looked out there. I didn't see any cats. Shut it. Walked down the hallway. Looked under. The lights were on, so I figured she's up. Opened the door.
The fuck? I heard a weird fucking cat sound. My wife got stabbed.
First arrived, the blood was
sounded like my wife being murdered.
Immediately fresh, if you understand me. The blood on the floor was no longer pooling when the police arrived, but had soaked into the carpet, which also struck the detective as unusual, because this was a nice part of town, safe, and the high-end carpet that was on the floor of the room, you know, it wouldn't usually soak up that much blood that fast. It's like the blood just like evaporated into the carpet or something. Which, you know, the detective would write in his little report that, you know, Mark, he called right after, you know, she was murdered when he heard a cat. It seemed like this had happened a few hours prior.
Yeah.
Not like
isn't that how it always
before
goes?
The police arrived kind of thing.
Good afternoon. My name is Thomas Eichelshaft.
Yeah, he has no lower body.
This is the press conference for the Duenas homicide. Mark Duenas reported he found his wife, Karen, inside her home with chest wounds. Upon arrival, deputies and EMS personnel located Karen Duenas inside the residence, and she was pronounced dead at the scene. There was also some pedestrian foot traffic that was in the area.
Whenever I see this, it reminds me of like Twin Peaks or
those witnesses, people have been contacted.
Like Deadly Premonition, like the backdrop like that.
Suspicious reported or observed by them. Detectives have continued their neighborhood canvas and evidence search area efforts, utilizing a canine from the Department of Fish and Game. And that canine is what we
maybe she just had no blood
search canine, and she has been successful in the past in discovering articles from crime scenes.
And so the investigation continued, and the authorities told the worried and scared people of Cottonwood, who were fearful, you know, a madman could be on the loose, to chillax. You know, we got this under control. We have a you know, a person of interest.
Person of interest is a person that we're definitely interested in, we're looking very strongly at within the case. We're not prepared to name that person as an official suspect as of yet. As my staff said in recent days, based upon the information they have in their investigation, we have at this time, there is no increased danger to the general public.
Yeah, when those rumors began to spread about who was the prime suspect, the family was like, no. Yeah, they just weren't having it. There's no way, you know, Mark, he could be the suspect. Like, you're taking the piss here, come on. Mark and Karen loved each other.
Maybe you should listen to the police when that
is. Why would he kill her? Pooh, get your tongue out of your ass and find the real killer. This was because the police learned of, from Mark directly, actually, that there was, I don't think you'd call this an affair, but there was another woman, a married woman.
What was going on in our life, and it scares me when I think about it.
They weren't banging, but they had been messaging each other, and Karen had found out. So Mark said he wouldn't message her anymore and gotten a secret phone. He volunteered this to the police. A couple of years before this all happened, Mark got on this newfangled thing called Facebook. It's gonna be big. He got on there and started yapping away to a girl he knew
all
in school.
All because of Facebook.
And while they didn't actually meet up, I love yous were shared. Multiple I love yous. Now, mind you, they hadn't seen each other since the 70s, so I would have liked to see in those profile pictures. So yeah, Mark kind of had like a an online girlfriend, you know? Hey, she's real, I swear!
Then, you know, we kind of got carried away with a little texting here and there.
She was real. Real bad news for Mark and the murder investigation into his wife.
Was there ever any pictures sent or anything like that, or was it always just...
There's pictures of,
it doesn't look like he's doing too good in this.
Her, you know, just little innocent,
innocent stuff. You know, maybe a little titty.
What a weird dude.
You know, we're not into any of that nasty porn. None of that. Right. It was just, what do you look like now? You know, she sent a picture of her and she goes, your turn. She does a quilt, or she took a picture of her quilt. Showed it to me.
Right.
This innocent stuff.
She
had a picture of her and her grandkid.
And that's why your wife is dead now?
Stuff like that.
Now this woman, however, she did end it. And what? About 3 months before May of 2012. But to the police, this was like manna from the heavens.
She'd be doing that nasty stuff on her quilt.
I didn't do it. And I mean, it's crazy.
Okay, it's just like OJ. We need to be out there finding the real killers, right? LAPD, they didn't have to go find the real killers.
I know you're doing your job, but I would never lay a hand on my wife. I did not hurt her. I did not kill her. I walked in and found her in her condition.
They wanted to use this as motive.
When did you find out that Karen was going to leave you, Mark?
Leave me? She's never going to leave me. Never going to leave me. Honestly.
In fact, during the interview,
just
Mark
passes
said,
out.
Maybe her husband, quote, went psycho or something and, you know, killed my wife. Maybe it was the hubby, just not that one. And they lived in Idaho. So, and in fact, that night, they were at some kind of church function. So due to that,
alibi.
This woman and her partner were ruled out. So how rocky was the marriage? Actually, well, the family said it was great. They confided in their kids all the time and everything was...
Kind of just like looks sketchy. Story. I don't know.
It wouldn't be though for Mark.
If those mushroom cuts... I don't know, dude.
5 months later, in October...
Like, he looks guilty, right?
Mark was arrested. He was charged with first-degree murder.
For the first time tonight, we are hearing from the family of the Cottonwood man...
Mike Mangas.
...his wife last year. Mark Duenas was arrested...
Yo, imagine if that was your name. Man. Mike Mangas. Oh, that must be fucking rough. Growing up as Mangas. you could probably smell me from the other room. My name is Mike Mangas, and I had Burger King for dinner. I can't. Come on, man.
And accused of killing his wife last year. Mark Duenas was arrested in October for murdering his wife.
I'm Mike Mangas.
Nearly 20 of Mark's supporters gathered at the Shasta County Courthouse this afternoon. They included his family, friends, and his co-workers. Both the Duenas family as well as Karen's family continue to maintain his innocence.
The trial went ahead in the summer of 2013. Mark's family were with him the entire time.
If your last name was just Mike Manga.
They were all there in support of Mark together. The prosecution said
you'd have to be a weeb.
The murder was that woman, the woman he'd been messaging on Facebook. The woman he had stopped messaging and never actually physically met her. Yes, so you know, something happened that night between Mark and Karen. We don't actually know, so we'll make it up. But they thought maybe she was going to divorce him when she found out about the secret phone, and so he killed her. He killed her maybe, you know, after 10 p.m., then cleaned himself and made it look like...
Not a bastard.
What it looked like. So, what did it look like again? Well, somebody had wandered around the backyard. It was a warm, sunny day, but their footprints
you knew
were
him?
Still visible.
Yeah, this is in Shasta.
In the grass, so fair play to that. Then they cut the screen, but didn't actually go in that
Mike
way.
Mike Mangas in the morning.
In the crack. They said, fuck that, entered the house some other way, wandered into Karen's room, murdered her while sounding like a cat, and then just left without leaving a trail of blood behind.
What was the cat sound thing?
Another job well done. So after Mark, you know, could have possibly done all of this. Then he waited for Casey to arrive home before calling the police. And in fact, he actually wanted Casey to be the one to discover Karen, you know. But instead, he went straight to bed, so Mark had to be like, oh, cats, and then went in. And that's when we get back to that 911 call.
911, your emergency?
It sounds like you said I shot my...
You know. But instead he went, oh, cats, and then went in.
And
that's when we get back to that 911 call.
911, your emergency?
I got a...
I can't not tell.
What did he say? Did he say, A?
I got a... I'm sick.
That was the prosecution's, you know, finger guns moment.
Really?
The defense said it was obviously, you know... I mean, I'll play devil's advocate here for a minute, but...
That was a piece of evidence?
Said, I found my wife sick.
It doesn't. But I don't know if he... But that could be evidence? Karen,
but they say that's not true either.
Now that the 911 call has been made public, it is obvious that our father said no such thing. However, we are fearful that the damage had already been done.
And it's clearly, you know, if he did say on the phone that he killed her, why didn't they arrest him that very night? You know, why did they wait?
My wife's bleeding everywhere, dude.
Now, though, in a jailhouse interview, Mark would say that he thought the police had finagled with that recording, that it wasn't even him who said that. You know, true to the magic of editing. The defense would also say, you know, remember neighbors saw other people, they saw a car whizzing by, you know, footprints. Who cut the screen? If you don't believe it was Mark. The jury couldn't decide, which, yeah, I suppose to be fair, maybe you might be in the same boat. And so a mistrial was declared.
We all support Mark. Yeah. We don't think that he was capable of this.
I just want to make a simple point. You see these people? This is love. This is belief in this human being. This is not questioned in our hearts. Please listen to us and know we love this man and he's a good man. That's all. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, church choir witness. You guys may now leave in your bus.
Whatever you said on the phone could be given more credence. Being a being an actual slip of the tongue. When you look back and see this piece of interrogation footage.
Like the guy knew. Well, I think that's what they said. It was a church. Pretty sure.
He cut her.
Is it really?
I didn't know that. I saw it, and there was tons of blood, but there was none there coming out when I
cut her and she bled.
I don't.
I mean, for fuck's sake.
That He's would like be all used
in
place.
The second trial, which began in November 2013. What would also be used in the second trial was more evidence. Evidence of blood on Mark's clothing. It was Karen's blood, and it wasn't visible to the naked eye. Only by using good old luminol. Kinda actually seemed to be everywhere, and although some of it could be explained by him touching Karen when he found her, and then touching his shirt, not all of it could be. And it's like, what was on his shirt? It wasn't bloody enough.
Oh, Shasta actually from Shasta? I guess that makes sense.
She had been cut open with a knife. So it wasn't bloody enough to have done that. Yet it was bloody enough to have traces left. Which is interesting. That would then lead back to him, you know, maybe cleaning his clothes before his son came home after seeing, you know, the Avengers. They also found in the kitchen a knife. One that could possibly have been the weapon.
It's a nice knife.
A, in the wrong slot, and... That's men for you. And B, possibly had some kind of cleaning agent on the
normal house. Friday night. So, send your kid out to see Avengers. Kill your wife.
Time, things weren't so good for Mark.
Pretend now, there's cats outside.
I guess to come to a conclusion, but they sure did. Mark Duenas was found guilty of first degree murder. Duenas done did it. He was sentenced to 25 years to life in prison.
25.
Since then, Mark, you know, he's appealed, but it was soundly rejected. He's not going anywhere. In fact, neither is his son Jacob, the second oldest, who's now joining him in prison.
Really?
Jacob, a former California highway patrolman, was caught diddling kids. He got 26 years for that one.
And he's the son of the other guy?
For his dad.
Yeah, that kind of fucking
and so ends would wreck you. Of Mark. It's an interesting one in that
fucking
you can kind of see both sides. You could see how he could have and couldn't have.
Like, it makes you think, like, what the fuck were these people doing?
More on the could have.
And they're always church people.
You're gonna, you know,
hey, what's up, Freya? How you doing?
We don't say it over the phone. You know, on the phone to 911. Mark really should have written that rule down. But the why to me has never really made sense.
Yeah, that's pretty crazy. It's a very small world, Eric Flynn.
Why did I have to walk in?
What a bad fucking actor, dude. I love this it when they show that after the fact. Why did I have to walk in on it? He doesn't even look like he gives a shit.
Did he walk in on his wife with his secret phone and...
Was he about to take a nap?
I mean, who knows? Is there ever really, a reason for a why? You know, to murder. I mean, I suppose I could break out my life insurance stance once again. But I won't. Thank you so much for watching. I really appreciate it. And I appreciate you.
This channel's called That Chapter.
Take care of yourselves, and I'll see you as always real soon in the next.
And like I said, he puts out a lot of videos. And they're all really well done. I like his channel. So if you like forensic files, murder mystery kind of stuff, he does it all. It seems like whenever I go on YouTube and I'm like trying to find something to watch, I'm like, what do I want to watch today? And then he'll post a video and it's like, thank God, there's something to watch now. You know what? Watch some Connor O'Malley real quick.
Everybody's sitting around not doing fucking shit. Meanwhile, the markets are in turmoil. That's why I come down here, Wall Street, and I'm handing out free homemade Powerade to all the stockbrokers.
I love this guy so much. This is one of my favorite people.
We gotta get this shit up. We can't be fucking around. It's gonna be fucking something else. It is a fucking new day. That's why I came down here. I said I'm gonna give homemade Powerade out to all the stockbrokers. This is water that I worked out over it to give the power into the haze. Yeah. Homemade Powerade.
Guys, guys, I made homemade Powerade.
The Fed said the Red Hot Chili Peppers are going to come out with a new album and try and get the stock market up.
All hands on deck, all right? So that's why I got the Powerade.
This is Connor O'Malley. He's from Vine.
Over the Powerade all fucking day.
He's so fucking funny. I love it.
Guys, we're handing out homemade Powerade, trying to get the markets back up.
Everybody knows that one.
He's actually married to Ada Bryan from SNL.
More fucking jacked up.
It's very strange.
You want some homemade Powerade? Homemade Powerade. We gotta open up the Red Hot Chili Pepper markets. We gotta open up the Audio Slave markets. We gotta open up the Velvet Revolver markets. We gotta get alternative rock from 2003 back up in this fucking shit. Excuse me, sir. Homemade Powerade. I made some homemade Powerade. I'm trying to get the stock market back up.
He takes it. Why are you taking it?
We gotta fucking do this. We cannot be fucking around. This is game time. Please, please. Give it away now. Yeah, come on.
You guys gotta.
I love his videos. The problem is so many of his videos have, like, copyright music in it. Jaywalking.
Connor Malley, we're down here on Hollywood Boulevard, and we're about to hit the streets to do a little segment called Jaywalking. If you remember, Jaywalking is a segment from The Tonight Show with Jay Leno.
Where would you find chlorophyll?
Probably in your toilet.
After going, hey, why don't I take that segment from Jay Leno? I'll do
look
it
at
myself.
His shirt.
I'm gonna talk to people and ask them simple questions that, of course, all these dumb
people get like fucking wrapped up.
He's sponsored by Raytheon. Raytheon does protect us, and I'd like to thank everyone at Raytheon for making the missile. Silly stuff like this. Let's hit the piss silk streak on Hollywood Boulevard. What's the temperature of water that freezes?
Freezes at 0 Celsius.
Who's the Queen of England?
Elizabeth.
What's that capital of the United States?
Washington, D.C.
Damn it. Have you watched Tonight Show with Jay Leno?
Always.
Do you remember that segment? You remember that segment, Jaywalking?
Yes.
I'm trying to do that. And everybody knows all the answers to the questions.
That sucks.
Fuck. Fuck.
Did you see all the power rate out there?
I try to get a gun every day, and they won't let me.
All right. Meet me in my car in half an hour.
Yeah, that's right.
What fucking... That guy looks so fucking creepy.
What do you do?
Like a big baby. That was like Boss Baby.
Not like the big boys like Office Max stuff, but other smaller retail office supply store chains.
You've been jaywalked.
What? He's like so hurt. He looks so hurt by it. Scarier than anything we watched tonight.
Why do you steal from Jay?
I love this bit.
Don't you understand? He just wants to bring joy to the world. Why do you disrespect him? You steal jaywalking and you pervert.
What's up with like the nose percent?
I respect him. It's an homage to him.
Don't you understand? Jay just wants to tell jokes at 11:30. Jay is a saint.
Jay is a saint.
Jay lives off of stand-up.
I know. I think that that's so cool. Please.
Automobiles.
I like automobile too.
I like automobile too.
For thousands of years, there's been a Jay telling jokes about Viagra, rehabbing steam cars, and eating Italian beefs. I have created a Jay for every generation. You will be my next.
Yeah, it's like he does look like an Andoran. Look at his face.
You steal jaywalking and you pervert it?
I don't steal. I respect him. It's an homage.
It's an homage. His fucking face. He just like walks up to the car. Yo, what's up, Rissa? Looks like a raid, dude. You guys are doing well. We're just watching some dumb YouTube. You must be. Hope you're doing well. What's up, Rissa? Thanks for the raid. Hope you're good. Oh, God damn it. It's, I think it's muted enough that it wouldn't get claimed.
This might age me, but back in my day, getting juiced is when O.J. Simpson murdered you.
9-hour MHR stream? Damn, dude. That makes me tired thinking about it. I don't know how you do that.
I trifled with the ancient.
It looks like Stan Smith from American Dad is animated on his shirt for a second. Consequences,
but instead I got punished with this fucked up ass looking Jay Leno. What? It's not a curse. It's a blessing. I get to be a servant to the people. Spreading jokes about Viagra and making fun of that dumb fucking bitch who burnt herself at McDonald's with the coffee. Remember that shit in the fucking 90s? Oh, dude, coffee's hot, you fucking idiot.
Raytheon's integrated air and missile defense assets continue to watch the skies day and night, keeping the U.S. and allies safe around the world.
I want a missile sponsor.
Proven and deployed around the world today.
I could sell cruise missiles.
Customer success is our mission.
Yeah, I always get like hungry after a couple hours. That's my problem. Like I'm like start thinking about food at like 2-3 hours and then it's not good. Like I said, he has a lot of great videos, but like there's a lot of copyrighted music in it. What's the name of that band at the end of that? That song was on the radio like every 3 minutes a few years ago. Or actually, that was like 8 years ago. When the hell was that? So it's hard to be sure like which of these are appropriate. Okay, this one. No, it's got fucking Black Eyed Peas. It's the first song in it. All right, this might be good. Yeah, that's true. I just gotta take breaks. The Minion Squad.
It's me, Connor O'Malley, 30-year-old man, having fun on the BQE and going the opposite way on the highway because I'm a part of the Minion Squad. Minion Squad? Minion Squad? Minion Squad, Chase Bank, Minion Squad, Go Girl. Looks like I might be able to get on the BQE today, guys. On the BQE, have the time of my life. The highway is actually a pretty freaking safe place to be. Chase Bank's got the best app around. You can download different ringtones.
Chase Bank.
I met my wife on the Chase Bank app. I work for the highway system. I'm a part of the Minion Squad. We're trying to. I'll walk with you.
I work for the
We're
highway
to spread
system.
Awareness of the highway through Minion Squads. So if you and your family want to come out this weekend, we're shutting down the whole BQE. We're gonna have fucking nuts, dude. Yellow X Terrace and shit. Email me at minionsquadleader@gmail.com. We're having a big meetup this weekend down at the World Trade Center Memorial. All the Minion Squad guys, we're gonna be in Minion Squad.
All the Minion Squad guys are gonna
minions
be.
Minions, ladies be ladies too. Muslims, Christians are part of the Minion Squad. Jewish people are part of the Minion Squad. Part of the Minion Squad. It's me and my dad. I like when the horns be popping off on the highway. Y'all hear about the freaking Minion Squad? Come on! American highway system is one of the safest highways in the world.
I think there's another one too of Minion Squad. These are a couple of years old now, too, so. Minion Squad Highway Edition. Minion Squad Milwaukee Edition. Here we go. Milwaukee, what a beautiful city. Except not.
Hey, what's up? It's me, your boy Kyle Mallory. We're down here in downtown Milwaukee.
Yo, what's up, bang?
We're popping off on the Minion Squad, going door to door, talking to people, trying to spread awareness of the fucking Minion Squad. We're gonna get 4,000 people to join the Minion Squad today.
4,000?
You popping off on Minion Squad?
No.
You wanna join the Minion Squad?
No. We're a witch.
Check out the Minion Squad, dude, please. Please, just look at it once, we'll get one view. Come on! If you're an enemy of mine, I'll fucking kill you! I will never. And this is my pledge to all women. I respect you, I will never touch my prick.
54 months.
Only time I touch my prick is to piss.
Thanks for all those subs, dude.
Get my prick out of the way of shit.
Always nice seeing you around.
What's up, dude? You popping off on the Minion Squad?
Popping off on the Minion Squad.
I'm the founder of the Minion Squad. I started the Minion Squad in 2007 at my son's funeral, and we're looking to get it expanded.
Wow. Amazing. Sorry about that.
You get sorry about that?
You get 50,000 rewards points that you can redeem to put anyone you want into a cage for 1 year.
Well, you know what?
Why would you apologize for the Minion Squad?
A year or so.
Cheap. Chop. Cheap. Chop. Yeah! Should I talk about the Minion Squad?
Oh, the Minion Squad. I don't know about that, but I know the Minions.
Yeah, the Minions. That's what it is. It's a version of the Minions.
Movie?
No, it's a new movement. We're trying to turn ourselves into Minions.
Really?
Yeah, we're trying to become...
That's pretty cool.
That's pretty cool.
Tap, tap, tap.
A lot of, I get a lot of,
right?
Yeah. Mike Wang.
Book bag's open. Watch out. Some sneaky little cheapie can come to take your folders.
Maybe.
That's right, bitch. Don't fucking touch me. These fuckers ain't home. This is the worst day of my life. Sometimes I feel like I'm the only motherfucker trying to get the Minion Squad to pop off. And I feel like people just treat me like fucking shit, and they think that like I'm going to be around to carry on the Minion Squad, and I'm going to go to Milwaukee, I'm going to go walk up the highways, I'm going to knock on Sylvester Stallone's door and ask him for donations to the Minion Squad, but it's not that easy. And if I don't get at least one person to join the Minion Squad today, I'm going to rip my genitals.
That's what I mean. The issue is he puts too much copyright music in his videos.
I don't think so.
Like that? I don't like that, man.
Meet and greet with Jerry O'Connell.
And, it's too. I think it's 20, just too loud. It'll just get picked up by the fucking the machines. I just wish he would put a little bit less in. Yeah, there's a lot of other really good ones, but I wouldn't probably watch any of these on stream. Because some are like super political. What about this one? I don't know if this has music in it or not. But I would recommend checking him out. His name's Connor O'Malley. God damn it, man. It's not super loud.
What's up, guys? It's me, your boy.
It's not like he's doing anything that would get him banned, though.
And it's time for I came down to this mall to get my haircut before court, and I noticed.
Yeah, they would just take the money for those.
So I decided to make this little video to try to get teens to come down here to the mall and save the mall. So hashtag teens save the mall.
Why does every mall look like this now, too? Well, I know why, but.
Yeah, that's no easy, man.
No, it's not easy. That's why I gotta be a strong guy, you know what I mean? Mama! I never meant to hurt you!
Heights don't exist, you know what I mean?
I like pizza. I like malls. I like malls. I like malls. I like malls. I like malls.
Look at this.
Wow.
But here you go, I'm gonna give this back to you, and it is video proof that I did not hurt anyone. I did not hurt anyone. I refuse to hurt anyone. You know what I mean?
It's, he edited it.
Show this to the judge.
Right, yeah, I've seen Kyle's videos. I love his videos. Kyle's videos are better than his entire SNL career. They fucked him over so bad on SNL.
I'm zooming in on the Asian's face. She's
awesome. What? I think it's just like random footage.
You guys, something. You gotta come down here and you gotta save the fucking mall. You gotta save it. Look at this.
God damn it, man.
Set.
Yeah, making a YouTube video. What's your name?
Jay.
Jay, what's up? My name's Connor. We're trying to hashtag get the teens down here, save them all. You know what I mean?
This fucking guy.
Come around here?
Alpha.
Where's that? That's all right by here, right? Yeah. What do you think of the mall?
I think it's a shithole.
Yeah? What do you think they should do with it?
I think they should knock it down and build like a fucking amusement park or something here.
Fuck yeah, dude. Adults only amusement park, you know what I mean?
Like
you know,
yes. Playboy Mansion or something?
Fuck yes, you know what I mean? Dude, get some
fuck.
Fucking MILFs down here and shit. Get this whole thing soaked with female nut. You know what I'm talking about?
Hell yeah.
Because one time.
Yeah, we got adult amusement park.
Italian grill.
He's just talking to this random guy. Italian girl.
I wish I could sit in that chair. Well, dude, I'm just out here in the fucking parking lot screaming like a dumbass trying to make a stupid fucking YouTube video, but.
Hey,
have
man,
a good day.
What's it going to be on there? I want to look at it.
It's going to be on X videos. Have a good
day. Have a good
one. Right, dude, you have a good one. Yep.
It's gonna be on X videos.
Actually, he's never on.
Yeah, yeah.
Hey. What's up?
Hey, I've never recorded it.
Oh.
I got a call, so I couldn't really.
Oh, who called? It's okay.
A walk-in customer.
That's honestly fucking fine.
Hey.
Yeah. All right. No camera? Okay, I'm gonna kill it right now.
Hey. No camera. Yeah, some of these are really good, but I'm gonna do one more of his videos and I'm gonna move on. He's got some really, he's on a bunch of other channels too. But like I said, he's married to Ada Bryant, who's like on SNL. When I found that out, it kind of blew my mind.
What's up, guys? It's me.
$500 cigarettes for a 5G.
Your boy Connor O'Malley. I've teamed up with T-Mobile and Verizon to smoke 500 cigarettes for 5G. 5G is the strongest signal that's ever been invented,
and no 5G signal is more reliable.
We're out here trying to raise
500 cigarettes.
5G.
I'm doing this in loving service of 5G, T-Mobile, Verizon. I'm not getting paid because I think we're lucky to even have it.
5G is God. Man created God. Man killed God. Then man went ahead and created a new God. And a new God that is called 5G. This is a real 100% heartfelt thank you to Jack Ryan. Jack, thank you so much for making sure that we are safe. Once out, then the United fucking States will be done with the Contra virus, okay? If Courtney would let me back in my fucking house, I would love to be fucking quarantined with my fucking kids. I love my little fucking kids. The fat one, the tiny one. I told the ex-coworker that I wanted to do this and they laughed in my fucking face. They said, you will never fucking smoke 500 cigarettes. for 5G. But guess who's proving them wrong? I am. It's going to help you do computer faster. You're going to be able to play on chat rooms better.
You're going to help you do computer faster.
You never even fucking heard of, okay? 5G going to make ebombsworld.com a real planet. 5G! 5G! 5G!
5G service activated.
This shit is so fucking fast.
This is how you get 5G. That's why I mean, though, like, sometimes it gets like, it's too crazy.
Burlington 1 moving in.
Burlington, go back to kill Jeffrey Epstein. Information about the Contra virus. He tried to warn us. He tried to stop us.
We got a lock on target.
The Burlington Code Factory killed us. Get in.
Fire.
Burlington Code Factory. They got cheap coats, but they're fucking everyone else over. Ah, oh, damn it, it's a song. I think I watched the Miller Time one. Oh, this one's awesome. Yeah, I think we watched this before. We'll watch it again.
Life is exactly like a video game.
Mm-hmm.
I got the cheat codes. My cheat code is confidence, and I put it in every day.
Every day.
It's not to, you know, triangle, circle, left, right, up, down. It's take a shower. Comb your hair, get dressed, look yourself in the mirror and say, I'm the number one fucker. I am a new being made of digital flesh. I have merged with the cyber.
The Eminem in the background. I've merged the flesh.
I can take my arm and I can put it out incredibly fast. And if your face happens to be in that space, then my arm is traveling through incredibly fast. Oops. Oh, well. Looks like you got punched. Sorry.
You got punched.
You're going to have to go to the back of the line now because lunchtime is over, little baby. Keep your father close, but your enemies closer. Godfella, part two.
Amazon, go.
In my religion, God is a computer, and his only son is Master Chief. For those who want respect, they must give respect. Nicolas Cage, Gone in 60 Seconds, 2000.
Gone in 60 Seconds, 2000.
What? You to know. We live in age of computer. I know that if me and Leonardo DiCaprio were ever to meet, we would become friends.
Yeah, I love that he was able to film this like in just like a perfect time.
The food I eat, it's digital, and you wouldn't even be able to see it. I wish I could explain it to you, but it'd be like explaining mathematics to a turkey. had so many accomplishments, I can't even list them all. Graduated high school.
Drives by.
Finished all the side missions in Grand Theft Auto San Andreas. And I have conducted sex.
Graduated high school.
I'm a genius billionaire playboy philanthropist.
Avengers,
Tony Stark, 2012. If you don't pull up your pants in the morning, you might as well just take your fucking head and put it underneath the car and let it drive over it. Because you're pathetic. You either live long enough to be the hero or you die trying to be the villain. Dark Knight, 2008.
Put your head under the car. Dark Knight. That's maybe my favorite one. It's just dumb. I wish she had another one like that. What else do we have? I think that's really all the good ones that we can do. I think this one's okay.
What's up, guys? My name's Connor O'Malley, and I'm an actor!
Acting is my passion.
I'm an actor. I was affected by COVID-19.
And I know a lot of people are hurting, but I was especially hurting. You know, I was ready to be in the Gucci hat on the runway at the show.
I'm about to be an influencer for the planet. This is a call to action. Any brands out there, I'm willing to partner with you guys.
I'm doing sponsored content with Popular Mechanics. I'm doing sponsored content with Craftsman. I'm doing sponsored content with Sears Covington Collection.
If you guys got the dough, I'll do the show. Everybody out there, I'm so sorry about the racism. I really had no idea that it was going on, but can we just go back to the way you could go forward and do... I mean, of course I want to, you know, do remembrance, but I also want to keep having, you know, like we lost Toys R Us this year.
Not only am I going to look like Mark Wahlberg in 4 months, I'm going to be meeting him, and I'm going to be pitching him a bunch of VR ideas.
So let's...
We lost Toys R Us this year.
And the rumors that are out there are not true about me. I don't know what to tell you guys. I'm a good guy.
Age 17. Height 5'4". Weight... Would love to play a military law enforcement. Good guy roles only. That's him. Based in the U.S. Virgin Islands, but will fly to L.A. for auditions. God is my agent, LOL, but I do need an airy gold in my life, though. Connor O'Malley, acting info forever at yahoo.com. I don't know if this has anything weird in it. I think this one's good to go. Oh yeah, this is a cool one. This is his last video. He hasn't posted anything else since then. The Hustler Club. The man who has discovered the newest cryptocurrency called Fuckcoin. Probably, it's just a coin. Fuck coins can be used like Bitcoin. Yeah, you probably can't show that. Damning footage of Corb with a stranger's Amazon package surfaced. Corb can be clearly seen attempting to fuck the package. Listen to who it is. Look who it is.
Are you fucking my Amazon package?
I don't know how to fuck.
What do you mean you don't
know? I don't know how to
fuck. You were fucking on my Amazon package.
I don't know how to fuck.
Get out of here. Kill yourself, you fucking piece of shit.
A lot of
Listen to that voice again.
My Amazon package?
I don't know how to fuck.
What do you mean you don't know how to fuck? You were fucking on my Amazon package.
I don't know how to fuck.
Get out of here. Kill yourself.
It's Coffee Man. That's right. It's Vince. What's his name?
A lot of unease and bad vibrations in the market.
It is absolute chaos on the streets.
United in our resolve.
Time is almost up.
The government collapses. A healing anthem.
I'm trying to learn how to fuck, but I don't know what to do. So I'm running around the neighborhood fucking on the box. I'm just a kid, I don't know how to fuck. I'm trying to learn, please live, give me some luck. I'm sorry.
The Lin Manuel.
Power of music, it's weird, isn't it?
Hi, Corp. It's Ed here, and that was perfect.
You are awesome.
Thank you. All the things you have done.
Colin Powell of Rack War. Yeah, that's Robert De Niro.
They forgive you.
Thank you for your courage.
No one's perfect. We all make mistakes. But I want you to know, Corb, I didn't break a single law across a single line.
Your song, I mean...
There he is.
It fucking moved me. I gotta adopt you so I can really teach you how to fuck.
Don't worry, you'll make the hole, okay? There you go. More hip action.
He's got a corn mask on.
Come on, grab the box. Grab the fucking box.
Hard. Fuck.
You're fuck, you. I love you. You made me very proud.
What's that guy's name? What's the coffee guy's name? Is it Ray or Vince? Vic DiBeto. That's his fucking name. I think at least. Yeah, Vic.
Hey, does anybody want coffee?
Zick DiBeto. I don't know how the fuck
hey,
to say.
Hey, what do you hear? What is?
I think he just, that's all his videos. It's just like him in his car talking.
Or thumb to swab my exhaust pipe, so do me a favor, just drop me off and walk home, and I will call you when I'm done.
I tell you, boy, you really, I am blessed to have you, Alexis. You want
this guy
to take it urgent, kid. They're gonna swab.
But not all his content is him, like, going into the store and yelling coffee. He just, like, sits in his car. DiBeto? Yeah, he's the coffee guy. All right, I think that's enough Connor for tonight. I don't have any other videos that aren't, like, super political, I think, that he's made. He's just, like, at, like, you know, like, rallies and stuff like that, like, antagonizing people. You could do an all gas. I don't know if we should do all gas, no brakes. Because he doesn't even own his channel anymore. It's like, I shouldn't even watch their fucking videos, you know what I mean? I wonder if someone will upload his video somewhere else so we can, like, watch them without giving the ad rev to, like, fucking whoever fucked him over. Oh yeah, he's totally like Eric Andre. But like I said, he's actually on TV now. Ada Bryant, I don't even know if she's really... She's good on SNL occasionally, but she's not really known for anything. Is actually married to him, so she got a show on ABC, I think, last fall. So he's actually been on television, and he stopped making YouTube videos, unfortunately. Or he's making less of them. And I kind of hope the show goes under so he makes more YouTube videos. Because I don't... It's like a sitcom. This is, like, totally different. Yeah, let's change gears a little bit. I know those videos are funny, but let's do some a little bit more. A little spooky.
Have now.
So, here it is. Actually, did we watch all this one?
For a diner.
Rainbot is a kind of like, not just horror. She does a lot of like murder mysteries and stuff like that too. You know what? This will be a better transition. This is a 40-minute video. I don't want to watch that, actually. Here's a better idea. We've watched this one before, but it's a classic. And it's on YouTube. So it's all good.
On the season premiere of BuzzFeed Unsolved, we take a look at The Watcher, a stalker who was active as recently as 2017.
This fucking guy. I love BuzzFeed Unsolved. It's like,
too,
unabashedly.
Too soon for me.
Okay.
Normally, I love this show. Covering like cases that are way back.
But
The
Watcher
day.
Is
this
one of my favorite ones.
About. He may watch this show. I don't know. And he could take a little.
He probably will.
Trip down to sunny California to visit his pals Ryan and Shane in the studio.
Or maybe he'll just be outside the studio, like.
Let's try to bury that down. Put it in a box. Put it aside.
You know what? I'm loving the energy this season. Let's hop right in. Let's do it.
Let's get into it.
Ooh.
In June 2014, Maria Broaddus, her husband Derek, and their three young children were getting ready to move into their new home, 657 Boulevard, in Westfield, New Jersey. The six-bedroom, $1.3 million house was their dream home, located only a few blocks from Maria's childhood home in what was then the 30th safest town in America, according to the website Neighborhood Scout.
Doesn't
a
mean
mere
anything.
3 days after closing the sale, before the Broaddus family had even moved in, a letter arrived at their new mailbox. The new owner was written by hand on the envelope in thick, clunky letters. The typed letter began, quote, "Dearest new neighbor at 657 Boulevard, allow me to welcome you to the neighborhood," end quote.
Hey, it's me.
The letter, however, was anything but welcoming. It went on, quote, "How did you end up here? Did 657 Boulevard call to you with its force within? 657 Boulevard has been the subject of my family for decades now, and as it approaches its 110th birthday, I have been put in charge of watching and waiting for its second coming."
The house
my
of Bilbo Baggins.
Watched the house in the 1920s.
My 111th
and my father
birthday.
In the 1960s. It is now my time.
Sounds like a Batman type. A silent guardian.
Yeah.
Just sounds like it's in
his
blood.
Yeah, he's just like Batman.
You know?
It's a nice sentiment. If that sentiment, however, entails you doing some weird things, then maybe it's not a good family tradition.
Who am I? There are hundreds and hundreds of cars that drive by 657 Boulevard each day. Maybe I am in one. Look at all the windows you can see from 657 Boulevard. Maybe I am in one. Look out any of the many windows in 657 Boulevard at all the people who stroll by each day. Maybe I am one.
Jeez, dude.
This is 2014 and he's writing like it's the 1800s here, like a little, it's a teaser.
I don't think that's what they're thinking.
Oh, well.
Also, like, I don't know how many houses you've moved into. I've moved into quite a few apartments. And even then, there's usually some kind of welcoming gift from, like, either the property owner, maybe even the neighbors will bring you cookies. If I walked into my new house and the first thing I saw was a letter that had this madness inside of it.
Nobody brought me cookies.
Nobody brought you cookies?
Actually, the first place I moved to in L.A., somebody took a poop on the doorstep.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
The letter also mentioned specifics about the Broaddus family. Quote, "You have children. I have seen them. So far, I think there are three that I have counted. Do you need to fill the house with the young blood I requested? Better for me. Was your old house too small for the growing family? Or was it greed to bring me your children? Once I know their names, I will call to them and draw them to me." End quote. In a cursive font, the author typed the signature, "The Watcher."
What do you think now? Do you think your original thought may be a little bit off base?
Yeah, maybe. I want to give him creep points for this very fun, old-timey threat of I'm going to steal your children.
True.
He's like the Wicked Witch.
He's making himself into a caricature of a villain, for sure.
After receiving the letter,
he said
the
he would just draw them to him.
Out
he didn't
to the couple
say he was
that had
steal
sold
them,
them the house, John and Andrea Woods. The previous owner said they have never received any letter like that in 23 years of living in the house, except once, a few days before they moved out.
Except
the
once.
The Woods family said they never felt watched in the more than two decades at 657 Boulevard, and in fact, rarely felt the need to lock their doors. While they thought the note they received was odd, they threw it out
the letter
without
said
much
no junk
concern.
Mail.
Well, this
that.
Is kind of like when you buy a house and they didn't disclose
the
to you
the Vidyabum saying it's showtime. We're doing a watch party when that's
haunted.
Up. And I know, I should probably start having your table description of it on there.
On tables without you doing it.
This isn't something
the Amazon watch party when
like
that's happening.
There's been a death they have to mention. They're not going to be like, it's beautiful. It's 2.5 bathrooms, 3 bedrooms. There's a watcher and a beautiful pool in the back.
No big deal. Have fun with that.
Still, the Woods family went with the Broaddus family to the police to report the letters.
All right, now we're just watching YouTube.
The police instructed the couples to not tell anyone about the intimidating mail, including their neighbors, were all deemed suspects. 2 weeks later, with the Broaddus family still not moved in, a second letter arrived. Disturbingly, this message contained more details about the new owners, including their name, though misspelled, and their children's birth order and nicknames.
What?
The author also referenced seeing their daughter painting on an easel in an enclosed
porch
space.
You fucking tell somebody
asking, quote,
to help you at
this
point.
Is she the artist in the family? End quote.
You know what's the most disturbing about that to me is the nicknames. Because it's one thing to look up people's, like, birth names. The idea that they would have nicknames, pet names, means that it gives you the idea that they may be listening.
Do you think he bugged them somehow?
You think
it's
so?
Possible. Who knows what this guy's capable of? That's, I guess, the premise I'm trying to set up.
Okay.
All right.
Other parts read, quote, "It has been years and years since the young blood ruled the hallways
the
of the
young
house.
Blood.
Have you found all of the secrets it holds yet? Will the young blood play in the basement?
Isn't that like
or
Wolfenstein?
Are they too afraid to go down there alone? I would be very afraid if I were them. It is far away from the rest of the house. If you were upstairs, you would never hear them scream. Will they sleep in the attic? Or will you all sleep on the second floor? Who has the bedrooms facing the street? I'll know as soon as you move in. It will help me to know who is in which bedroom. Then I can plan better." End quote.
This
After
is why
receiving this letter,
you shouldn't
Maria
open your
and
mail.
Derek stopped bringing their children to the house and put a hold on their plans to move in. Several weeks later, a third letter arrived. Quote, "Where have you gone to? 657 Boulevard is missing you." End quote.
He's not good.
You don't like
is
the way he
just calling
around
the children young blood?
He calls them young blood, which, like, in some cases, it's like kind of cool. Like an older person goes, "Hey, young blood."
Yeah, that's fun.
That's fun.
But not a man who is.
That's fun.
Young blood ruled the hallways of the house. He's talking about like them as
kids
little blood
running
bags.
Around.
Little blood. It's not good.
However, by the end of
little
the
blood
year,
bags.
The investigation into who the watcher was
it
had
is
stalled.
Not cool.
There was no digital trail, no fingerprints, and no way to place someone at the scene of a crime. Meanwhile, the stress was taking a mental toll on the Broaddus family. Derek said he was experiencing depression. Maria's therapist said she was suffering from PTSD, and both were afflicted with levels of paranoia that made much of their daily life seem threatening. Only 6 months after the letters
arrived, I would just start knocking
arrived,
on people's doors,
they
probably.
Decided to sell the house. Like, due to rumors
right,
about the property, however, buyers were hesitant. The Broaddus family sued the
Woodses everyone always thinks
for
he sounds
failing
like
to
chills
disclose
a
the threatening letter they'd received.
Just sound like a fucking
local
goofball.
Reporter found the complaint, which included excerpts from the letters. His small story became a viral sensation, causing a media circus to swirl around the house. Now totally unable to find a buyer, the Broaddus family considered selling the house to a developer who could tear it down and split the property into two homes. The two plots, however, would each be
then
less than
the?
3 feet too small for the mandated size of the neighborhood. The Broaddus family appealed the rule to the neighborhood planning board, who unanimously
well, yeah,
rejected
chill sounds
the proposal.
Very, way more
What's
exaggerated.
What's the logic in splitting it up into two homes?
It's like when something really bad happens at a hotel.
But it's
and
like
then
the
they
same
just
thing almost.
It's kind of what they're trying to do here.
Like the idea
which is
of
like
him
understandable.
Changing his voice.
I just think it's crazy that the neighborhood was like 3 feet too small. Can't do that.
Hey, regulations are
the
regulations.
Rhythm.
I get that.
Yeah, that's like the
Maria
the
was understandably
Amber.
Upset, saying, quote, "This is
Amber?
My town.
Kinder?
I grew up here. I came back. I chose to raise my kids here. You know what we've been through. You had the ability, 2.5 years into a nightmare, to make it a little better. And you have decided that this house is more important than we are." End quote. It should be noted that in 2018, the Westfield Planning Board approved splitting up a different lot around the corner from 657 Boulevard, one that required a larger exception than the Broaddus family requested.
This is just a bad neighborhood.
Or do we think, perhaps, is it a hot fuzz situation where everyone in the neighborhood
is in on it?
Yeah. And
oh,
they're like,
yeah, yeah.
"We don't want this new family here."
Oh, yeah, yeah,
the
yeah.
Greater good.
The greater good.
The greater good.
The greater good.
That Christmas, some families who had vocally protested the Broaddus' plan received threatening hand-delivered letters signed Friends of the Broaddus Family.
Well, that's kind of weird.
More on these later. In spring of 2016, just short of 2 years after the first letter arrived, the Broaddus family found someone to rent the home. The family had two large dogs, fully grown children, and a clause in the lease that let them out if there was another letter. Within 2 weeks,
another letter arrived. So they
told them
about it? I guess arrived. That's pretty
Quote,
fair.
To the vile and spiteful Derek and his wench of a wife,
what?
Maria.
Okay, hang on. Oh boy. Before this, he's been very respectful, despite saying like, yeah, I'm gonna steal your blood children.
Yeah, he was really holding back before. Wench, too. He's still wench. Stuck with the old English, though.
The wench.
No shaming.
657 Boulevard survived your attempted assault and stood strong with its army of supporters barricading its gates. My soldiers of the boulevard followed my orders to a T. They carried out their mission and saved the soul of 657 Boulevard with my orders. All hail the Watcher. End quote.
There they go.
All hail the Watcher.
All me and my minions, we all
I've
did it.
I've done it again.
And I've done it
like
again.
Like my father and his father before him.
Yeah, one thing I've always said, I've always gone on record saying all hail the Watcher.
That's true, he has said that. He says it every day when
MO
he walks into the
day
office.
One. All hail the Watcher. Starting. I walk into BuzzFeed. More
yeah,
all
it's like a Renaissance fair actor.
You do the same thing. It's like,
all hail the Watcher?
Threatening to fucking
I've got
kill
my,
them.
My big stomach tattoo that says that.
That's
but
true.
I don't want to reveal that right now.
There was HR complaints.
The letter continued, quote, maybe a car accident, maybe a fire, maybe something as simple as a mild illness that never seems to go away, but makes you fall sick day after day after day after day after day. Maybe the mysterious death of a pet, loved ones suddenly die, planes and cars and bicycles crash,
bicycles
break. You are despised by the house and the Watcher won, end quote.
What the fuck?
This guy sucks.
He's just really just shooting them out there. He's casting a wide net and hoping one of them sticks.
Yeah.
So that he could be like, if one of those things happens, he's going to be like, all me.
Watcher baby.
Orchestrated by the Watcher.
They're like walking down the street. They kind of trip on the sidewalk. And he's like, yes, all hail the Watcher.
Run out of cooking oil? Watcher.
Oh, mosquito bite? No hail the Watcher.
Oh, you just took a little poopy and you don't have any more toilet paper? Watcher.
Ryan
sorry.
Is so fucking
despite
weird.
The letter, the renters agreed to stay after more cameras
ruined it
were
with that
installed
joke,
around
man.
The house. Now up to current day, it's time to look at suspects for who the Watcher could be. Our first suspect is a man I'm calling the Gamer. Around 11 p.m.
The
one
Gamer.
Night, while two detectives from Westfield Police were surveilling 657 Boulevard, a car suspiciously stopped outside the house. The car was traced to a young woman from a town close by. The home of her boyfriend was on the same
oh, no,
block
it's the gamer.
As 657 Boulevard. The woman told investigators that her boyfriend was into, quote, some really dark video games, and including possibly one where he played as a character called the Watcher,
what?
According to an investigator's memory. The Gamer agreed to be questioned by police, but he never showed up for his interviews. Detectives didn't have enough evidence to force him to come, so he was never questioned.
They said he played as a
dark
character called the Watcher,
video games.
According to the investigator's memory. So maybe he didn't say Watcher, maybe he said The Witcher, which is a game.
Knowing how people who don't know about video games react to video games, I'm guessing this is...
Yeah, and if people judged you, for instance, off of how you play video games, I'm sure they'd have you behind bars. Pronto, right?
I don't know what you're implying here.
We did murder.
That was Sims
characters
fun.
That
everybody murders people on The Sims.
They were characters based off real people, our coworkers, in fact.
Stephen, little Stephen Lim.
Stephen Lim, the Try Guys, we murdered them all.
Yeah, we did.
That was good.
I mean, killing your coworkers
the
in a work video
suspect
is kind of
is another
weird.
Neighbor, Michael Langford.
Derek
began to
fun.
Suspect Langford after attending a neighborhood barbecue shortly after receiving the first letter. Langford lived in the house next door, which belonged to his 90-year-old mother. Several of her adult children, all in their 60s, lived with her, and the family was seen as strange but harmless. The Langfords had lived in the house since the 60s, which was when the Watcher claimed his father watched the house. Michael's father had died about 12 years before the first letter arrived,
Watcher,
which could
Watcher.
Have been why the Watcher claimed to have done the job of watching for, quote, the better part of 2 decades, end quote. Langford was also known to spook new neighbors with his odd behavior, like walking through their yards and peeking through windows. Due to the positioning of the houses, Langford would have had a perfect view of the easel they had set on the porch for their daughter that the second letter referenced.
So you're telling me he has a habit of
walking into people's lives.
Invading people's privacy.
Why isn't there any, like, fucking watching people watching the street? Why aren't there cameras and shit?
Suspected him of being the watcher.
If I moved in,
should not have said
I was
watching.
Like, wow, this place is great. And I just turned to my window and saw.
Well, you know me. My greatest fear is looking at a window and then just seeing a face there with two eyes just watching you like that.
Not even a smile, just a...
I actually think a smile is worse. I used to have a recurring nightmare when I was a kid of an evil version of my dad looking through my window. It stemmed from when I watched Inspector Gadget as a kid. And you remember there was the evil Inspector Gadget?
Did he have big, giant teeth?
He had big, giant, shiny teeth. And he had big eyes, so he would just stand outside my window.
And your father is a dentist, so the big, scary teeth are even...
That's true. And we all know that he may have cut someone's head off.
Hey, I didn't say it. I did
that's
not
true.
Make
it's
that
just
I fucking love Inspector Gadget.
At this point.
Police questioned Michael Langford after the first letter, but he denied knowing anything, and there was little evidence to connect him. Because the police's interview was before the second letter, some believed it would have been especially reckless for Langford to continue sending letters. As well, those who knew him largely vouched for Langford, thinking him incapable of writing
letters. Mike Bataille was in here the other night. I hope he doesn't mind.
I'm pretty done with neighbors and family members saying,
I think he's accepted it now.
No one could have seen it coming.
Tell you what, that John Wayne Gacy is the sweetest fella.
Ted Bundy, he's got the eyes of just the kindest man.
A real dreamboat.
Yeah, there's no way Ted could have done that.
Like, charming is all hell.
You know what serial killers
are good at?
Yeah,
he likes it now. Okay, that's good.
Being charming.
I feel bad about saying it.
That's how they get you in so they can kill you. So I'm just done with that whole narrative.
The Broaddus family, working with the police, sent a letter to the Langfords telling them they were planning on demolishing the house in hopes of drawing the Watcher to write again. There was no response. Casting doubt on Langford is a test later performed on one of the envelopes which found DNA that belonged to a woman.
Finally, someone gets a fucking brain here.
Abby may be the Watcher. An investigator compared the DNA to that from a water bottle used by Abby. No match. Shortly after this DNA test, and without explanation, prosecutors informed Derek and Maria that they had ruled out any of the Langfords as suspects. Which brings us to our third suspect. The Broaddus locals found it suspicious that the Broaddus family was over the years able to move from a $315,000 home to a $770,000 home to a $1.3 million home with refinanced mortgages. Some accused the family of getting in over their heads with the home and turning to a desperate ploy to get out of it. Some neighbors wondered why the Broaddus family kept renovating the house after they decided they wouldn't move in. When major movie studios began courting the family for the rights to their story, a big media deal could have been more motivation for concocting The Watcher. What's more, I mentioned that some local families received anonymous threatening letters after the Planning Commission rejected the Broaddus' proposal to split the lot. Those letters turned out to be written by Derek.
Look, this guy's nicer than me. I think if people denied my proposal and I saw that they were speaking out about it, I'm confronting them in the parking lot. I'm not doing it through anonymity.
Friends of Ryan Bergara aren't going to be...
The friends of Ryan Bergara are right here and right here. And they're going to be going face-to-face in that parking lot.
He'll get you.
You don't need a case for that.
Yeah, he'll get you.
Don't bring the investigator. Bring the ambulance. You know?
I love it.
Yeah,
that's
right.
Scary.
Yeah. All right,
Ryan. Derek claims those letters were the only anonymous letters he's ever sent and were the result of years of frustration at his family's plight and the neighborhood's seeming ambivalence. As well, the psychological trauma from the letters alone makes the Broaddus family being the Watcher
stock footage of that guy,
casting more doubt on the theory that the Broaddus family is the Watcher. A later investigation found that another family on the boulevard
that's
had
the conspiracy.
Also received a note from the Watcher around the time the Broadduses received their first. Just like the previous owners, the Woods family, that family had lived in the house for years without a problem and threw the letter away. But if the Broaddus family was trying to get out of their home or make a movie deal, why send a letter to another house as well?
Seems a bit preposterous that someone would make up a mystery about themselves and hope
sully the waters, maybe, to like dilute the story.
Pretty far-fetched.
Yeah.
How do you explain that to your kids? The psychological trauma you're going through is
like,
you know, be a really fun role-playing exercise to put together as a family. What if we pretended, picture this, that a man was going to murder you in your sleep.
That's pretty fucked up.
Unless, of course, the children were in on it, and they're, like, in a writer's room. Like, they're, like, walking around, like, a whiteboard.
The kids are pitching.
And the kids are pitching.
They're putting little index cards up
they're,
on
like,
the
They're, like, in their riffing, snapping around. Like, maybe.
I know you've got him, like, threatening the house. What if he goes after us? Yeah, the kids.
And the dad was like, write it. Let's write it down.
Pipes up. His father was a watcher. And so was his father before him.
Oh, my God. Legacy. It's a legacy stalker.
I know I'm new
I
to this.
I love it. I
know.
Love it. Print it.
What makes the case of the Watcher so fascinating
yeah, probably like teenagers
is the limited
in the
number of
like
potential
that.
Suspects, coupled with the complete lack of evidence that has stymied investigators' ability to make progress. This case is very recent, so there's a chance we haven't heard the last from the Watcher. Perhaps some future note will provide the key clue to identifying the person responsible. But until then, the case remains unsolved.
Unsolved.
Overall, a very
yeah, I like
frustrating
that one a lot. That's like my favorite episode they made.
He caused no physical harm, but he caused lots of mental harm, financial yeah. harm. People get away with things all the time in the past because it's, you know, there was the forensic technology wasn't there. This is 2 years ago. This is a little bit scarier.
But at the same time, we do live in a bit of a surveillance state. You go to the store to buy a bag of chips,
apparently
they got
enough.
You on 10 different cameras. I'm saying maybe the way the world has prevented him
yeah,
from
they're
really
all cliffhangers.
Doing something.
Doing worse.
I don't think
so
any of them
just
are really.
Write it out.
Yeah.
But he can't act it out.
Conclusively
right.
solved.
Who watches the Watcher?
He said it. Yeah, that's just BuzzFeed Unsolved. Probably the only good thing coming out of BuzzFeed. Really? Are they making new episodes? No. They did another season. They have like their own channel now too, actually, those guys. So they are on BuzzFeed on, you know, BuzzFeed Network doing, you know, content. And they started up a few series like Crazy History and shit like that. And then this is one of them. And then another one that's like Forensic Files kind of stuff. And that really, it really blew up. Like this has almost 5 million subs on it. And their videos get like millions of views. So people really like their stuff. Kind of like a really streamlined version of, you know, any creepy YouTuber. BuzzFeed content? Yeah, I know. It's ridiculous. That's why it's nice that they did branch out and make their own channel. Oh, wow. They don't even link it in the BuzzFeed network. That's funny. I guess it's just business, but what the fuck is the name of it? Is it called The Watcher? I think they actually called their network they made The Watcher. It is. It's called Watcher. And it's just them doing whatever they want, I think. Oh, they're like, hold on, I'll show you. Let me show you. Oops. They did like videos with Good Morning Mythical Morning. What is it called? Good Morning Mythical. What the fuck is the name of their channel? Oh yeah, they do have some other cool videos that are shorter on here. These are a little longer. This is like the same style of video, but it's just them doing their own thing. It's definitely corny. It's not for everybody, but I don't know, it's cool. Morning Good Mythical. My good mythical morning. I can never fucking remember how to say the channel name.